Hello, Internet. Welcome to another installment of Scott and James Drink Alcohol While Talking About History, the Punk Edition. We're essentially just talking about the political history behind the birth of punk. We're really just going to be talking about the 60s, mid-60s to the mid-70s. So we're not going to be going into what people would describe as like the heyday or peak of punk, especially with hardcore punk, like late, you know, 77 to the 80s onward. We're talking about what were the political and historical events and the cultural events that led to punk flourishing.
Also, just to add on to the sort of time span, like, you know, people associate the politics of punk with like kind of the anarcho-punk stuff that came in the end of the 70s, early 80s, and then UK 82 sort of British hardcore, and then how that sort of translates to the US. But we're like going before that when punk was like not yet kind of like as like uniform identity that it became.
We're mostly going to be talking about the US and Britain and a little bit about a few other places, but that does not mean that there wasn't so many other pre-proto-punk movements happening across the globe.
Arguably, the other places would be like potentially more interesting, but the like the sort of dominance of US and UK within punk is like, even though punk is like seen as a kind of resistant or counter subculture, it's a result of the hegemony of US economic and cultural dominance, you know, around the globe. And then the UK as a kind of like partner in that.
We're going over a very broad range of history, and we're obviously not going to encapsulate all of it, but we do want to kind of start with the end of World War II and the cultural phenomenons and the political tensions that came from the end of World War II in 1945. So why would we choose 1945? Why would we choose World War II? What is so significant about that war, specific to rock and roll, that makes it worthy of us having that be this starting point of this history overview? A lot of it had to do with how World War II propelled technology, how it propelled an intense new revamping of political tensions with different countries that led to the subsequent Cold War era. And it also started the first instances of youth cultures. One way or another, it kind of birthed the teenager. One could ask, what are you talking about, James? The teenagers have always existed. There's always been the age of 13 to 18. What do you mean that World War II created the teenager? World War II kind of prompted this idea of a consumer culture, and mostly this came out of the excess resources and supplies that the states, for instance, was making during this time period that people were trying to figure out what to do with. So there was a major economic boom and a major push to buy things, which kind of opened up new consumer markets. So that was one really big way, is that people started catering different clothing, different toys, and all this to different age groups. The first instance of the word teenager, like describing it as a group of people, happened in the magazine 17 magazine. What also came out is a different kind of ideology around what life was like after the war, what it meant to live in the present, what it meant to exist and be free and have autonomy. A lot of these concepts around growing and aging and living looked really differently after the war. So that was really big with how rock and roll got propelled, because rock and roll was kind of the music of youth.
There's a double-edged sword to this, where like youth culture is something that's packaged and sold to young people as a whole like segment of the consumer population. But then it also is a place where, like, you know, the people in power have a fear. And this is a hugely like racialized and gendered, sexualized issue. Arguably, all of American pop culture is dominant American pop culture is an appropriation of Black culture. We can see this, like, especially in rock and roll, where, you know, a history of like the blues, which was a primarily black music up until this point, crosses over to and changes into rock and roll and is then marketed to a white audience. But rock and roll is like, you know, is marketed towards white youth. And at the same time, there's this image coming up of the juvenile delinquent, which is again a kind of racialized image of the young person who's like rebellious. So like we think often of like people in like biker jackets and motorcycles and like greased up hair.
Hey, somebody tell me what that means. BRMC. What does it mean?
Black Rebels Motorcycle Club.
Isn't that cute? Hey, Johnny, what are you rebelling against?
What do you got?
Another way that like rock and roll began to be appropriated from Black culture, specifically the Deep South. So Louisiana being one of the, Louisiana and Mississippi being essentially the birthplace of blues and rock and roll. Is through the radio. After World War II, there was an excess supply of radios, and that became a major way that people started to hear about different music. And a lot of it was that they were trying to figure out what to do with all of these radios after the war. They were like, what the fuck are we going to do with this? So the concept of PM radio playing music, have disc jockeys emerged from them just trying to capitalize on this excess supply of radios. Radio was a way to share Black music without anyone having to be confronted with their color. So people started to listen to all these different blues musicians, and oftentimes they wouldn't even share the names of the artists, or they would whiten the names in order to play it, because there was even a regulation about playing Black made music. Another thing that really infuriated a lot of conservative people that led even more so to seeing the youth as degenerate delinquents is that rock and roll also ended up bringing Black and white and different racial teenage groups together. And isn't to say that there wasn't racial tensions during that, but the mere fact that there would suddenly be dances and concerts with multiple racial groups together infuriated these older racist adults. There is this way that rock and roll ended up really challenging how diverse racial socialization happened. Yeah.
This also is like also sexualized, which goes hand in hand with race, right? So like the fear of rock and roll is a fear of a kind of like dark sexual power that would be coming from like Black culture. And you have like these various versions of like mainstream white co-optation. So like Elvis is a early rock and roll, you know, like superstar. Who has to be censored in various ways because like he's already translating like the Black blues music that he saw in the South into something that's palatable for a white audience and like more country tinged. But like when they show him on TV, they can't show his hips, right? Because he's like moving too much. And then like-
Jingling his dick too much.
What?
He was jingling his dick too much. That was so provocative about it.
Right. And then even Elvis has to be cleaned up into like Pat Boone, right? So there's like, levels of like the danger. And then someone like Chuck Berry, who's often seen as like one of the early like Black rock and roll musicians and is like super influential for like the basic punk riffs like that go through the New York Dolls to Johnny Thunders and Sex Pistols, was someone who like, you know, he was arrested for transporting minors across state lines, which probably had some problematic sexual politics involved, but was also a highly racialized kind of criminalization of Black people, right, crossing state lines and being policed. So there was like various ways that rock and roll made people money, but also caused like these kind of moral panics around sexuality. So to end World War II, to get to the end of World War II, US and the European allies had to make a pact with Russia, right? Because Russia ended up being the ultimate like defeat of the Nazis in the Eastern Front. But once the war was wrapped up, the US was in a position to kind of claim global dominance, especially because of the destruction of a lot of Europe from the Nazis. So they were able to like, you know, there's a bunch of different kinds of economic agreements, and we don't have to go into all of that, but US gains a sort of global dominance, steps into the place of the former empires, and then positions itself basically as this like free world capitalist democracy against the communist leftist ideas that are purportedly embodied by the USSR. And this also is like a kind of geopolitical strategy, because the former colonies that are left by France and England and Germany and Italy and other countries are witness to independence movements of various sorts that the Western capitalist countries are afraid will go towards socialism or communism. And so the Cold War basically becomes this this standoff between the US and the USSR as the major superpowers, who don't literally engage in war front to front, although there's always this threat of nuclear fallout, because both of them have nuclear capabilities and everyone's sort of like ready for the world to be destroyed by a nuclear bomb. And the US has already used one at this point to show its strength and kind of maintain that dominance. But the Cold War also has played out in proxy wars in all the former colonies, where there's independence struggles and the US wants to make sure that the USSR doesn't gain influence. And we can see this especially in Latin America, in Africa, and the former colonies in Africa. Cuba is a huge place where the US like lost their influence and domination. So this also sets the scene for the US not only having economic, political, geopolitical dominance, but also this cultural hegemony that gets exported around the world and has a certain kind of value for those in the Eastern Bloc and USSR who are not allowed to consume Western culture because of its capitalist leanings.
World War II led to a major change in the economy and in media and technology that led for music to be more widely distributed. And it also led to a change in philosophy and psychology and how and socializing. And then that change that mobilized even further through the crises of the Cold War. Okay, so Scott, where did the word punk come from? And like, what was even the first band to be called punk?
Well, the term punk has various etymologies. One of them, interestingly, is a sort of prison queer slang term for, and also a term about gay hustlers.
During the 16th century and early 17th century, it meaning punk being someone who took it up the ass. It started slowly changing, and it what started to emerge in the US or in the Americas was punk meaning poor quality. And both in like the sound of a music and in like of a person. So we start seeing a lot of instances of musicians or artists or movies being considered punk out of like poor quality. And then that slowly emerged in the 50s as being synonymous with the delinquent youth. So Lester Bangs was one of the first people to use the word punk to describe a band, and he described it towards MC5. The quote that I have of him describing them as punk is, "Never mind that they came on like a bunch of 16-year-old punks on a meth power trip. These boys, so the line ran, could play their guitars like John Coltrane and Pharoah Sanders played sax."
I think it's also interesting and important maybe to talk about politics here too, because MC5 were this like, you know, think of them now as a proto-punk band who were explicitly political. And that's interesting to kind of trace punk back to them. And on the other hand, you have the Stooges, who are maybe more influential in the sound and of punk, who explicitly thought of themselves as apolitical.
Scott, what the fuck is up with punks and swastikas? What the fuck?
Yeah, that's actually a really important question that I asked myself as a young child, first witnessing, actually, it's kind of funny, the Madame Tussauds, Johnny Rotten, and Sid Vicious with swastika armbands. As a young Jewish person, I was like, oh my God, these guys are evil, and I need to know more about them. So in the post-World War II era, where these people, like, you know, the punks are all boomers, right? And they're raised by people who served in the war or were part of the war effort. And England was literally like bombed out by the Nazis. So the swastika as a sort of just like a kind of symbol of rebellion was like saying fuck you to the parents. It contained this sort of like evil seeming rebellious kind of power within it. But it's interesting because if you trace it back, I think maybe one of the first sort of like in the punk lineage, the people to wear swastikas were the Stooges, where Ron Ashton wore a swastika armband because his dad, who was a vet, like would get him memorabilia. And then you have people like Dee Dee Ramone, raised in post-war Germany, digging out Nazi memorabilia from wherever he was playing as a kid. And that shows up in punk songs like Blitzkrieg Bop, et cetera. So there's this like sort of this fear of the Nazis. And then also probably I would say that in the kind of, spirit of like situationist hijacking of symbols and meanings, it's a way to sort of show the fascist aspects of like the modern capitalist so-called democracies, right? Because you would see alongside the swastika armbands that people would wear, hammer and sickle and other kind of communist imagery, and kind of putting them side by side. So it's not to say that the swastika was empty of its political value, but it was used, I think, a lot for shock value. And it came up in the UK through Vivian Westwood in the Sex Shop, which is like the place where the boy band, the Sex Pistols, was created. It's interesting because the afterlife of this is that punk becomes a kind of battleground for recruitment for white nationalists in the UK and in the US.
The politics of World War II and the politics and the culture of the Cold War lasted and impacted 80s punk so much so that they felt the need to use that symbol. I'd also like to argue this is not the same now. I think that it is very, very historically specific, and it kind of just shows how the power and politics of symbols change with time.
I think it's important to note that there's like a slippery slope, if you will, between like the edginess of a swastika to the edginess of just being a fucking racist, right? And that's why I think like white punks who were trying to shock at some point could get easily recruited into like a straight up Nazi position, and depending on like how fucked up their circumstances were and like how hard it was for them to like survive in the time.
Would you say, Scott, that punk was apolitical during these time periods, or was it political, or was it both?
The way I kind of think about punk is that in the 60s you had these like big militant movements, and there was an aspect of like pop culture and rock and roll that seemed to be like fomenting a kind of revolution, and that was mirrored in these actual like movements like May 68 across the globe, right? We have like May 68 in France, we have the Democratic National Convention with MC5 in Chicago, and there's uprisings and in various other places at that time, and there looked like a revolution was like on the verge of happening. And as Grill Marcus like says in his famous book, he kind of traces the origins of UK punk back to the situationists in France, who, as I said, would like use these images and kind of try to subvert them by putting other meanings. And Malcolm McLaren and Vivian Westwood, who are like pretty influential architects of the style of punk in the UK, specifically use these kind of political slogans and political imagery from that. But on the other hand, where punk like arguably originated in New York, the scene was a lot less overtly political. It was more ensconced in a kind of high art world out of like coming out of Warhol's factory, the Velvet Underground, this kind of like different kinds of media too, just not only music, but like painting and poetry and art, pop art. So I think while a lot of those people might have radical politics or even conservative politics, the scene itself was, it was freer in ways in terms of its like ideas of gender and sexuality, but was like more, was less overtly political than when you get like the Sex Pistols sort of being like, I mean, arguably the Sex Pistols aren't super political, but they talk about political things. In the US, it didn't happen. With like the Ramones, I don't think got as much attention as the Sex Pistols did in the UK, for example. And it wasn't until the Sex Pistols came over to the US in the wake of the sort of moral panic that started happening in the US. In the UK, we have, leading up to punk, a series of different kinds of subcultures that are like identity types, going from like the mods, who kind of developed in response, I think I would argue, to like rude boy Jamaican culture, because there's an influx also post-World War II of Caribbean migrants from Jamaica and other places that were former colonies to the UK. So mods, and then mod turned into skinhead. And then you have like glam rock and then punk. So there's all these like types, rockers and teddy boys. And the subcultures were like more clearly defined as almost these like kind of like youth gangs, and they would fight each other. So in that way, I think it gives a more fertile ground for like kind of and like expressing a politics that go along with that, or a clear apolitical aspect. So like skinheads were working class, but not necessarily political beyond just being proud of being working class. Ska and reggae artists are political, although it's shot through a kind of Rastafarian worldview. And it's like it's a black nationalist kind of politics. But that becomes really influential in the UK because, as I was saying, like post-World War II, there's an influx of people coming from the former UK colonies into England, including, you know, people from the Caribbean. And so like white working class youth and black working class youth are coming up together in the same spaces. And there's a lot of cultural exchange there. So like the mods and the skinheads were listening to ska, which is a non-US cultural product, right? It's like coming from Jamaica and then coming to the UK because there's these connections. It doesn't really get into the US at all. And then by the time we get to the 70s, this is like, as I was saying, like explicitly political. It's talking about the apocalypse a lot of the time. Like one of the big songs coming up to 1977 by Culture is like When Two Sevens Clash, in Armageddon time, these songs that like the Clash would cover and took their name from. At the punk, one of the big punk clubs, the Roxy, Don Letts was a DJ, and he was a Jamaican born British person at that time who was hanging out with all the new punks, and between bands he'd play dub songs. So all the punks were getting turned on to dub. On the one hand, you have this history of like rock and roll coming from blues and like gospel and stuff like that, and progressing towards rock, which becomes like a more white kind of genre. And then, you know, you get to punk, where punk is sort of is trying to react against the forms that preceded it. And so kind of like took out the groove of rock and roll. That's something that like Johnny Rotten talks about, or John Lydon, whatever. In a way, you could see punk as like as an attempt to kind of like erase these like black roots, but it is actually like created next to this like radical political, like almost separatist sort of culture of like Rastafarian music. And so that, I think, actually creates a lot of the political ethos that comes into punk, even though like we get the depiction of punk as being a kind of white dominated scene. There is a lot of like cross cultural and interracial sort of like creation within the punk scene. You know, there are race riots in England against the police, like there are in the US all the time. And like right in 1976, there was a police crackdown in the Notting Hill Carnival, and the black community fought back against the police. And you know, the Clash write the song White Riots, being like, you know, we can question their politics here, but they're like, black people are ready to rise up against the state because it's like fucking in their face, and we need white people to do that too. I mean, that's the essential politics of the song. Although, tellingly, a song like White Riot could be misinterpreted as like white people need to rise up, and that goes into that kind of like Nazi afterlife of punk.
You see a lot of these, of the blending of these two music genres with the movement of Rock Against Racism and the Anti-Nazi League and the different concerts that they would have. They would book both reggae bands and punk bands simultaneously. What is that, the end of the late 70s?
The punk concerts had become like literally like people were fighting like Nazis all the time by the end of the 70s.
Speaking of fighting Nazis, I read that Crass denied playing one of the playing Rock Against Racism shows because they were opposed to violence, even towards Nazis.
Yeah, peace punks. You could say like a lot of the oi bands that weren't fucking Nazis or like reactionary right wing people were willing to throw down against Nazis to keep them out of their fucking shows and also to like not be co-opted by the Nazis. Unless you're a little band called Screwdriver. And then you're like, this is my ticket to the top. All right, James. So we said we'd talk a lot about US and UK, but there are other places in the world. Can you tell me why the fuck Japan and Sweden both became massive hubs for punk in the 80s?
That's a good question, Scott. I've been very curious myself. What made those places so special to create some of the best hardcore bands possible? I'm going to start with Japan. So Japan, unlike a lot of other Asian countries, became introduced to Western culture a lot sooner than a lot of other Asian countries, specifically with Commodore Perry in 1856. So after World War II, there was still American occupation. In these American bases, they had radios and they would play American jazz musicians such as Duke Ellington, and the Japanese were able to pick up those radio waves, and that jazz music was super, super, super influential in Japan. Much of the best and most like experimental Japanese rock actually was most influenced from the Japanese jazz music. So what kind of emerged was a really, really experimental psych rock scene in Japan that was heavily jazz influenced. And because of this extreme experimental arts, noise, psych sound movement that was also greatly influenced by traditional Japanese music, the jazz influence of the psych rock scene ultimately of Japan ultimately influenced the Japanese hardcore scene of the 80s. And we see that most demonstrated by the sound that's so distinct about Japanese hardcore, which is being more dissonant, more artful, more experimental with its tones and grain and noise that didn't necessarily align with US and British hardcore punk. One of the first Japanese punk bands was the band called SS. So let's now go to Sweden or Scandinavia. I'm going to jumble up those countries. In these Nordic countries, the role of the state as a supporter for individual artists has always been historically associated with nation building. So it's always been important to these Nordic countries to support artists. There is essentially public art funding. The Scandinavian countries had the highest count of metal bands per capita, which I don't know how they were able to collect that data, but I'm going to go with it.
And some like metal researcher pointing out how many metal bands per capita.
I believe it though. I totally believe it.
For sure.
And a lot of it has to do with this public art funding that they had. And this has been foundational to Scandinavian countries since the time that they had royal courts. Like, we've been seeing ways that arts and music has been funded by the state to build their small size market areas and to build their like concept of community and state nation building. Unlike a lot of other countries that had major regulations around what you could play, you know, terms of style and what you were talking about, those regulations didn't really exist in these Nordic countries. There's always been this ethos of doest thou will. That's really, really huge to what kind of prospered Scandinavian countries to be a big hub for punk.
That's interesting, because I would say like sort of in the US UK scene too, like, you know, it's the 70s where there's a changeover towards neoliberalism and the kind of demolishing of whatever safety nets there are. But like the UK punks were all living on the dole and living in squats, right? And then in the US, you could still live pretty cheaply. But then there was also like money in the record companies. So like people would like come and like start giving record contracts to all these punks who are living on the dole or whatever. And then they were like making money that way. So it's not the same as this kind of like weird nationalistic thing that the Scandinavian countries do.
Point being made, Scandinavian punk is funded by the government.
Statist bullshit. Now, James, this is all well and good, but I'm wondering also about Eastern Europe and those countries that were under a kind of Soviet domination. Why are they so obsessed with post-punk and techno?
Let me just say one thing first, which is that Stalin was a bad dude. He was a bad guy. So I'd like to attribute this, the birth of techno and EDM and post-punk, to Stalin sucking ass. So this is a major contrast to the Scandinavian countries, where there was a lot more of a laissez-faire attitude towards what you could play, where as post-World War II, Soviet Russia tried to keep all foreign music out of its country, especially with these capitalist and imperialist messages of rock and roll. It was incredibly difficult to, in the 1950s, early 1950s, to get not only just musical instruments, but to listen to anything remotely American or British or just anything that related to capitalism. But anti-communist propaganda radio stations would be set out outside, just outside the Eastern Bloc, would play some of this music though, kind of to reach these audiences in the Soviet Union. And it would actually reach a good portion of the Soviet population, particularly at night. And this is where they would play band music like jazz and rock. And these jazz and rock albums into Soviet Union, and they would find all of these crazy ways to share the music. Once the 70s occurred, they realized they couldn't stop rock and roll. It was too fucking popular. They're like, you know what? We're gonna do government organized rock bands. So we're gonna regulate the rock music. We're gonna make sure that everything they say is pro-Soviet, not capitalist, blah, blah, blah. And it wasn't really rock music. It was just essentially electric guitars on TV for the first time in Soviet Russia. They were called VIA bands. While these restrictions around just rock music began to be lifted, there were still a ton of limitations, and there was major lack of accessibility of electric guitars, any type of instruments that would produce a rock and roll sound. And it was still difficult to get these records to begin with. Continuing on, the birth of electronic music or industrial music, EDM, was kind of this unlikely outcome of the junk of Soviet age electrification. So for communism, science and technological progress was like their fucking gods. That was like the most important thing. Vladimir Lenin believed that, you know, to achieve these goals of communism, we needed to have complete electrification of the country. I don't even understand what that means, but he was just all about electricity.
They were trying to like quickly industrialize Russia because it was like a mostly peasant society up until the Bolshevik Revolution.
Engineers in the Eastern Bloc and in Soviet Russia had insanely limited access to Western audio technology, not just the instruments, but just to record music was very, very difficult to come by. So because of this lack of Western audio technology, these audio engineers would find their own ways of creating sounds and music and recording audio. And that resulted in the creation of synthesizers and recording equipment that had a very distinct sound that was different than Western audio technology. This lack of accessibility created this thriving underground scene of these music enthusiasts that would create electric parts and create these other music making machines that ended up being in this kind of isolated culture behind the Iron Curtain. They had to find their own ways of creating and inventing music that was accessible to them. I read also somewhere that because they weren't really able to always play 45 RPM vinyls at the full speed rate, it created a lower tone and a lower beat, which then became that like lower, darker sound, like of like bass tones became more synonymous with Soviet wave because of the slowing down of these vinyl records that they would get their hands on, which are often incredibly poor quality. So yeah, electronic music, post-punk, very dark times in Soviet Russia. It's cold there too, cold wave, freezing. Moscow seems really cold.
I mean, it's interesting because it has the sort of like the technology and like material circumstances very explicitly determine the like cultural form.
Yeah.
Which is very Marxist. It's very Marxist.
Very Marxist. Cheers to Marx.
And so, okay. So we were like interested in talking about this stuff because we love punk. We're total nerds for punk and history. And politics, and we're both anarchists, and we're kind of like, why, you know, we came to anarchism through punk, and so what is the connection between anarchism and punk, and why is it like a kind of entry point to a radical politics, even though, you know, many of your favorite crusty D-beaters maybe have never been to any kind of direct action in their lives. I was listening to you and thinking just like, I like punk despite the bands in a way. I love the music that all the bands make, even if they're fucking sellouts. But the thing that punk like did, and in this way it's like actually very connected to the kind of commune movements of the 60s and the hippies, it gave a place for like an alternative community and a different way of living for people. So like, you know, maybe these bands signed contracts and got fancy boots and fancy clothes, but a lot of them were living in like squats and collective housing. You know, Crass event had the house that eventually became like a land trust, and they were experimenting in their kind of lifestyles and actually embodying a different way of life. And some of that translates into the like lyrics and the political messages that they were saying, but it's also like you get into punk because the music is experimental and different from like the norms that you hear, and there's like a fucked up noise that you want to hear, and then the lifestyles that go around it, even if they're not like explicitly politicized, and I wish they would be more, shows you like a different kind of community that you can enter into, and that for me gels with my understanding of anarchism.
I don't think that punk would not exist as it is without a complete rebuttal against political systems that led youth and marginalized people and working class communities to want to create music that was antithetical to what was happening during that time period. And you know, like there are times where a punk is apolitical, but I also recognize that the concept of being apolitical, you know, in the Cold War, where there was so much talk about political divisions, there was something political about not giving a shit about any of that. And I also want to state that this was also a time period where major social movements were beginning to prosper. Anti-communist in Europe, or anti-capitalist, or, you know, pro-communist in different areas, and anarchist groups, you know, even things like just the Students for Democratic Society or lots of other things. All of this, all of these radical social movements and rock and roll are synonymous with each other. Rock and roll ultimately ended up being the music of the people, and the music of the people revolting against normalcy. And there's no way that we can talk about punk without talking about all of these other radical social movements at this time. They were so closely related. There are actually moments where people who looked punk would get arrested.
Yeah, in England in the late 70s, they like started arresting people on suspicion. Or on sus, as they say in the punk songs. And that was just based on how you look, which is like another interesting aspect of the kind of racial history of punk, because it's like a form of like self-chosen marginalization by like dressing differently and like signaling that you have like a counter stance to the dominant form, which is different than like being racialized in like the way that you just like are born and look, and then that is given its own political meaning. So punk in a way like is people choosing to take this clear, explicit stance. And so if you do that and then are like, you know, I don't give a shit about people's freedom or whatever, it's total bullshit, because you're like co-opting self, like this sort of like place of kind of resistance, and then making it just white.
Well, thank you, Scott, for being a part of this conversation with me.
Thank you, James, for teaching me and learning along with me.